equal circuit of transformer. To understand this, it is important to discuss about ideal transformer, and it is also important to discuss about the effects of resistance and reactance. Let's discuss about ideal transformer. Ideal transformer is that in which there are no losses, that is no copper losses, no core losses, and in which the winding resistance is zero and the leakage reactance is zero, which implies that in ideal transformer there is no leakage flux. And in ideal transformer, the core permeability is infinity, which implies that in ideal transformer, for the flux to set up, it requires very, very low MMF and efficiency is 100%, which implies that input power is equal to output power. Let us consider no load case. So if input supply is given, then the current flowing in the primary winding is I0, and as this flux is of alternating nature, then according to Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction, here in primary winding an EMF is induced, and that is represented here with E1, and the same flux is now linking with the secondary winding, and so according to Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction, here an EMF is induced in the secondary winding. Let that be E2, and let the terminal voltage be V2, and here the secondary winding is open circuited, so current I2 is 0, so secondary current is 0. Now let's draw the phasor diagram for this. If suppose this is the flux, fine, as the primary winding is of inductive nature, so V1 will be exactly in 90 degrees with flux phi, and we know that transformer provides 180 degrees phase displacement, that is 180 degrees phase displacement between input voltage V1 and output voltage E2. And in phasor diagram, this represents E1 and this be the E2. And here we consider step down transformer, so is why E2 is less than E1. In ideal transformer, permeability will not vary. So is why flux phi and no load current I0 will be in phase. As here in case of no load ideal transformer, there are no losses, so the entire input current is used for magnetizing the core, so is why I0 is equal to I mu. It is discussed in case of ideal transformer that input power is equal to output power. So observe here that in case of no load transformer, I2 is 0, which means output power V2, I2 is 0. That implies input power is equal to 0, which means that the power intake of no load ideal transformer is 0. Therefore, the losses in ideal transformer are also 0. Now, when load is connected, then there will be current I2 flowing in the secondary winding of transformer, and because of which there will be flux phi2, and this flux will be in opposite direction to the flux phi1, and this flux phi2 will decrease the flux phi1, and obviously at a moment induced EMF will get reduced, but to maintain this induced EMF, transformer will drag more input current from the input supply, and that extra input current drawn is I2 dash. So now input current I1 is equal to I0 plus I2 dash. Therefore, I1 is equal to I0 plus I2 dash. And it is discussed that in case of ideal transformer, input power is equal to output power. That is V1 I1 cos phi1 is equal to V2 I2 cos phi2. And to satisfy this condition, phi1 must be equal to phi2. Which implies that in case of loaded ideal transformer, the transformer will drag power at the load power factor from the input. If suppose this is the phasor diagram for the loaded transformer, this be the E1 and let this be the E2. As there are no losses, so V1 is equal to minus E1 and E2 is equal to V2, and this is the I0 which is equal to IMU. And let us consider the load to be inductive load, Then when load is connected, current I2 will be in lagging with E2. Let that phase angle difference be phi2, that is, let the power factor angle be phi2, as I2 dash is equal to K into I2, and for K is equal to 1, I2 dash is equal to I2. So current I2 dash will be like this, and this angle will be phi2, and it is known that I1 is equal to vector sum of I0 and I2 dash. So the resultant is I1, but it is seen that phi1 must be equal to phi2. Phi1 is the angle between V1 and I1. So to have this condition, phi2 must be equal to phi1, and to have this, I1 must be equal to I2 dash. That is, I1 must be shifted to I2. Then only phi1 will be equal to phi2. But this will happen only if I0 is 0. That is, if this is 0, then I1 is equal to I2 dash, which implies that I0 is equal to 0. That implies magnetizing current I mu in case of ideal transformer is 0. This is the important relation in case of loaded ideal transformer. Now let's draw the phase diagrams for ideal transformer on load. Now let us consider rest to load, and the common phase diagram what we know is V1, phi, E1 and E2 and I mu. As in case of loaded transformer, there are no losses, which implies that E2 is equal to V2 and V1 is equal to minus E1. And as here rest to load is considered, so current I2 and E2 will be in phase. As now I2 is decided, therefore I2 dash will be in exactly opposite to I2. And now the resultant of I mu and I2 dash is I1. But it is discussed that in case of loaded ideal transformer, I2 dash is equal to I1. Therefore, the phasor diagram for loaded ideal transformer is this. And now let's see the phasor diagram for inductive load. And the common what we know is V1 is equal to minus E1, and this is E1, and this is E2 is equal to V2, and this is I mu, and this is flux phi. And now as inductive load is considered, so current I2 will be in lagging with V2 by an angle phi2. So the opposite what we draw is I2 dash, and this is equal to I1. And to be more specific, you can write I mu is equal to 0, and this is phi1, which is equal to phi2. And similarly, let's draw the phasor diagram for capacitor load. So the common phasor diagrams are V1, phi, I mu, E1 and E2, which is equal to V2, and V1 is equal to minus E1. And now capacitor load means current I2 will be in leading with V2 by angle phi2, and in exact opposite direction I2 dash. This is phi2, which is equal to phi1, and I2 dash is equal to I1. But please keep in mind that practically ideal transformer doesn't exist. Let us consider the no load transformer. So if this is the flux phi, voltage V1 will be like this. That is, flux will be in exactly 90 degrees lag with the input voltage V1. And if suppose this is the induced voltage E1, that is of primary winding, and let this be the induced voltage in secondary winding, that is E2. As we know that the permeability will vary with excitation, therefore current will not be in phase with the flux phi. Let the no load current be I0. So this is the I0, and as now here I0 can be resolved into two components. One component along with flux called as magnetizing component, and the other component of current which is along with the input voltage is called core loss component or working loss component. Let us suppose the angular difference between the input voltage and no load current be phi naught. Therefore I mu is equal to I naught sine phi naught and IW, or can be represented with IC, which is equal to I naught cos phi naught. IMU will be 4 to 5% of full load current, and working loss component will be, that is working loss current will be 1 to 2% of full load current. Now let's study about the operation of transformer on load. Here we will come across the important concept like why transformer is a constant core flux device and why transformer is called as negative feedback circuit. Now let's see that. If suppose this is the input voltage applied to the primary winding of transformer, and as primary winding is closed circuit, so current will flow, and let that primary current be I1, and as current flows in the primary winding, then there will be flux phi1, which is of alternating nature because here input voltage is of alternating nature, and according to the Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction, as this is the stationary conductor and the flux is alternating, so there will be an EMF induced in primary winding. That induced EMF we are representing with E1, which is equal to N1 d phi1 by dt, where N1 represents the primary number of turns, and as this flux phi1 links with the secondary winding of transformer, then there is an EMF induced in the secondary winding of transformer, which we represented with E2, which is equal to N2 d phi1 by dt. And now as the load is connected, there is a current flowing in the secondary winding of transformer, let that be I2. Now as current is flowing in the secondary winding of transformer, then there will be flux phi2, and that flux phi2 will flow towards this direction, that is opposite to the primary flux. Please keep in mind that windings ought to be wound like this, that is phi1 and phi2 direction must be opposite to each other. As now flux phi2 is opposing the flux phi1, then there is a decrease in the flux phi1, which will obviously decrease the induced EMF E1. But to maintain E1, transformer will drag more input current from the input supply, and that extra current which is drawn from the input supply to maintain E1 is represented with I2 dash. That is I1 is equal to no load current plus I2 dash, because without load there is a current in the primary winding, that is I0, and because of placing load there is an extra current which is I2 dash, and together we are representing with I1. And now because of this extra I2 dash, there is a flux phi2 dash, which is equal and opposite to that of phi2. As phi2 dash and phi2 are equal and opposite to each other, they both get cancelled, and the flux only that remained in the core is phi1. So is why transformer is said to be the constant core flux device. So whatever the load that you place, according to that there will be flux phi2, and according to that the transformer will drag extra current from the input supply, so that there is a flux phi2 dash. As phi2 and phi2 dash are equal and opposite to each other, they both get cancelled, and the flux only that remain in the core is phi1. So irrespective of load, the flux in the transformer core is constant. So is why transformer is said to be a constant core flux device. And it is discussed that I0 is having two components, that is magnetizing current and core loss component current. Magnetizing current is for flux, and core loss component is for supplying the core losses of the transformer. Let us consider the step down transformer, and if suppose this is the input supply current I1, as I1 is having two currents, I0 and I2 dash. This is I0 and this is I2 dash, and further I0 is having two currents IMU and IC, therefore it is subdivided into IMU and IC. And from the phasor diagram, if you observe that IMU is in phase with flux phi and IC is in phase with V, therefore this is the schematic diagram of the actual transformer. And of this schematic diagram, this represents the ideal transformer schematic diagram, and the whole together represents the schematic diagram of actual transformer. Let us finish this circuit with load, because if there is a load, then only there will be current I2 dash. If there is no load, there will be no current I2 dash. So from this discussion, you must understand that irrespective of load, transformer is a constant core flux device. And now let's understand why it is also called as negative feedback circuit. We know that if this is the input signal, and let this be the system transfer function, and let this be the output signal. If output signal is fed back to the input signal, and if the feedback signal is decreasing the input, then that type of system is called as negative feedback circuit. And if the feedback signal is aiding the input, then that type of system is called as positive feedback system. And coming to the case of transformer, observe that input here is flux phi 1 and output flux is phi 2, and flux phi 2 is fed back to the input, and as flux phi 2 is decreasing the flux phi 1, so is why this system comes under negative feedback circuit. Therefore, transformer can also be called as negative feedback circuit. Now let us consider the resistive load case, which means here the output voltage V2 and current I2 will be in phase with each other. So we know that in phasor diagram, if suppose this is the transformer flux, and we know that this is the input voltage V1, and why flux is in exactly 90 degrees lag with input voltage means the primary winding is of inductive nature. This will be the induced voltage E1 in the primary winding, this will be the induced voltage E2 in the secondary winding, because transformer provides 180 degrees phase shift. So is why E1 and E2 will be in exactly 180 degrees phase displacement with V1. And in ideal transformer, we've seen that the no load current I0 will be in phase with phi, because their permeability is assumed constant. But in reality, with excitation, permeability will vary. So is why current will not be in phase with flux phi, and that current we represented it I0, that is no load current I0, and here load is placed, so there will be extra current I2 dash, therefore there will be resultant current I1. So as your resistive load is connected, so I2 will be in phase with V2. Let us suppose this to be the I2, and here we didn't consider any resistive drops or reactance drops, therefore E2 will be equal to V2 and V1 is equal to minus E1. It is seen that in ideal transformer, E1 I1 is equal to E2 I2, and if suppose load is connected, then there is an extra current I2 dash. That implies I1 is equal to I0 plus I2 dash is equal to E2 into I2, and neglecting no load current I0, which implies E1 I2 dash is equal to E2 I2. E1 by E2 is equal to I2 by I2 dash. And it is known that E1 by E2 is equal to 1 by K, which is transformation ratio constant K. That implies the relation between I2 and I2 dash is I2 dash is equal to K into I2. Therefore, I2 dash will be equal to I2 if K is equal to 1, and both of these are will be opposite to each other, because flux phi 2 dash and phi 2 are opposite to each other. Therefore, I2 dash will be like this for K is equal to 1. And now the resultant current for I0 and I2 dash is I1. And in this phasor diagram, we can also represent the components of no load current IC and IMU. This is the phasor diagram for R load. And now let's draw the phasor diagram for inductive load. For inductive load, if suppose we know that this is the flux phi 1, and let us suppose this is the input voltage V1, and this be the E1, and let this be the E2. And here we consider the step down transformer. So is why E2 is less than E1. And here E2 is equal to V2, because here we didn't consider any resistance drop or leakage reactance drops. So is why E2 is equal to V2, and as your inductive load is considered, therefore 2V2 current will be in lag with V2. Let it be lagged by an angle phi 2. And please keep in mind that the load current I2 decides the primary current I1. So as we first draw I2 and then according to that in exactly opposite draw I2 dash, and here considered k is equal to 1, so is why in exactly opposite direction, that is in exactly 180 degrees phase displacement, there is I2 dash, and we know that I0 will be somewhere like this I0, and the resultant will be I1. And you can also represent the no load current components IC and I mu. And now let's draw the phase diagram for capacitor load, and the same repeats here, phi 1, V1, E1, E2, but as here capacitor load, 2 voltage current will be in leading, let this be the E2, let this be the I2, and here we know that here it is equal to V2, so to V2 current I2 will be in leading, let the current be leading by an angle phi 2, and now to represent I2 dash, draw in exactly 180 degrees phase displacement I2 dash, because here we considered k is equal to 1, and we know that I0 will be somewhere here like this by an angle phi0, and now the resultant of I2 dash and I0 gives you the primary current I1. So these are the phasor diagrams of loaded transformer without the resistance and leakage reactance effects. Now let's study the effect of resistance. As here in transformer, copper winding is used, every winding will have a certain amount of resistance. And because of that copper material resistance, there will be some voltage drop. And in equivalent circuit, that voltage drop is represented as the drop across a resistance. That is, if suppose this is the transformer core, and we know that there will be insulation present on which the primary winding is wound, and on secondary side this is the secondary winding, and to represent the resistance drop in equivalent circuit, a resistance is taken like this. This represents the primary winding resistance, this will represent the secondary winding resistance. So if suppose this is the input voltage V, and let us suppose this is the primary resistance R1, and let us suppose this is the secondary winding resistance R2, and let this be the EMF induced in primary winding, and let E2 be the secondary EMF induced in secondary winding, and let V2 be the terminal voltage. Therefore V1 is equal to minus E1 plus I1 R1, and on this side if there is no load, then E2 will be equal to V2, but if load is present, then E2 is equal to V2 plus I2 R2. For resistive load or inductive load or capacitive load, this is common, that is flux phi, and this is the minus E1, and this is E2. So this diagram is common for R load, L load and C load. And here for R load, to get V1, we need to add I1 R1 to minus E1, but I1 is decided by load current I2, because I1 is equal to I0 plus I2 dash, and I2 dash is decided by I2. That means the primary current I1 is decided by secondary current I2. Therefore to get this, we need to first decide I2 current, and here to get E2, we need to add I2 R2 to V2. Therefore as here we are considering the resistive load, this will be V2, and the drop from here to here represents the I2 R2 drop, and I2 will be in phase with V2 because of resistive load. So as I2 is in phase with V2, therefore I2 dash will be here, and we know that I0 will be somewhere here, therefore the resultant of I2 dash and I0 is I1. As now I1 is decided, to get V1, we need to add I1 R1 drop to minus E1. So this is minus E1 and we need to add I1 R1. So I1 R1 drop will be parallel to the I1 phasor. So draw I1 R1 and now the resultant is V1. Next, let's draw the phasor diagram for L load. And the common thing from the phasor diagram is this flux phi minus E1 and E2. Now, as we are considering the inductive load to V2 and E2, current will be in lagging. Let it be I2. And if the secondary power factor is phi2, so from I with an angle phi2, draw V2. And to get E2, we need to add I2 R2 to V2. So I2 R2 drop must be parallel to the I2 phasor, like this. And as here we decided the current I2, this will decide the I2 dash. And we know that this be the I0 and the resultant will be I1. So to get V1, we need to add I1 R1 to minus E1, and I1 R1 drop must be parallel to the I1 phasor. So if this is the I1 R1 phasor and the resultant will be V1. Now let's draw the phasor diagram for capacitor load. And the common thing that we know is phi1 minus E1 and E2. So as your capacitor load to V2 and E2, current will be leading. And if the secondary power factor is phi2, so at an angle phi2, draw V2 from I2. And to get E2, we need to add I2 R2 drop to V2. So I2 R2 drop must be parallel to the I2 phasor. So like this. This will give the resultant E2. And now, as we decided the I2, I2 will decide the I2 dash. And I0 will be somewhere here. And now the resultant of I0 and I2 dash is I1. And to get V1, we need to add I1 R1 drop to minus E1. So from minus E1, we need to add I1 R1, which must be parallel to the I1 phasor. So this is the I1 R1 drop. Now the resultant is V1. So these are the phasor diagrams by considering the only effect of resistance with no leakage reactance. Sometimes for easier calculations and analysis, it is required to transfer secondary side resistance to the primary side or primary side resistance to the secondary side. But you must keep one point in mind here is that while transferring one side parameter to the other side, it shouldn't disturb any other parameters. And to accomplish that, the condition is the copper losses due to resistance before transfer is equal to copper losses due to that resistance after transfer. That is, if suppose the secondary side resistance is transferred to primary side and that transfer resistance is referred with R2 dash, and there is no R2, and the current in secondary winding is I2 and the current in primary winding is I1. Now let's apply this condition. So copper losses due to resistance before transfer. So before transfer, the copper loss because of this resistance is I2 square R2, which must be equated to copper losses due to that resistance after transfer. So after transfer, the resistance is R2 dash and the copper losses is I1 square R2 dash. That implies I2 by I1 whole square is equal to R2 dash by R1. And it is known that I2 by I1 is equal to 1 by k, that implies 1 by k square is equal to r2 dash by r1. That implies r2 dash is equal to r1 by k square. This is the important relation. Similarly, if you transfer primary side distance to the secondary side, that transfer distance is referred with r1 dash, and which is equal to k square times r1. This is another important relation. Now let's study the effect of leakage reactance. That is, if suppose this is the transformer core on which there will be insulation and on which there is a primary winding wound and a secondary winding wound like this, and if suppose this is the input voltage V1, and let us suppose this be the induced voltage E1, and let this be the induced voltage E2, and let this be the load. As it is known that of the total flux phi1, some portion of the flux will take the path of air. That is called as leakage flux, and this leakage flux is of inductive nature. Therefore, to represent that leakage drop, a reactance is taken, that is like this. Let us suppose this is V1, and let us suppose this is the leakage reactance XL1. So if this is the transformer core, then the winding will be like this, and from the secondary side there will be leakage flux, and because of which there will be some voltage drop, and that leakage flux voltage drop is represented with leakage reactance drop like this, XL2, and this is the load. Here we didn't consider any resistance drop, we considered only leakage reactance drop. Therefore, the voltage equations corresponding to this diagram is V1 is equal to minus E1 plus J I1 X L1, and V2 is the terminal voltage, so E2 is equal to V2 plus J I2 X L2. I2 is the secondary winding current and I1 is the primary winding current. And now let's draw the phasor diagram for this. And it is known that the common thing in phasor diagram when the load is connected is this is minus E1, this is phi, and this is E2. So to get V1 to minus E1, we need to add I1 XL1 drop, and to get E2 we need to add J I2 XL2 to V2. But as it is known that I1 is decided by I2, therefore first let's draw the current phasor I2, and in this case of leakage reactance V2 will be somewhere here like this. And let us consider the resistive load, which means current I2 and V2 will be in phase. So let us suppose this is the I2 phasor. So to get E2 to V2, we need to add J I2 XL2 drop. J I2 XL2 drop will be perpendicular to the I2 phasor. So from V2, draw perpendicular towards E2, because to I2, J I2 XL2 drop must be perpendicular. So from here to here, draw perpendicular, and this represents the J I2 XL2 drop, and the resultant will be E2. So as now here I2 is decided, then I2 dash will be decided like this, because here K is equal to 1 is assumed. We know that I0 will be somewhere here, and now the resultant of I0 and I2 dash will be I1. And as I1 is decided, now to get V1 to minus E1, we need to add J I1 XL1 drop, and J I1 XL1 drop will be perpendicular to the I1 phasor. So this is I1 phasor. So from E1, maintaining perpendicular to I1, draw J I1 XL1 drop, and the resultant will be V1. Now let's consider inductive load case, and the common thing here is flux phi, E1, E2, okay, and V2. As inductive load is considered, so to V2, I2 will be further lagging. So let this be the I2, and to get E2, what we must do? To V2, we need to add JI2 XL2 drop. JI2 XL2 drop will be perpendicular to the I2 phasor. So from V2, maintaining perpendicular with I2, draw perpendicular, that gives you JI2 XL2 drop, and the resultant is E2. And now I2 is decided, so I2 dash will be decided, and it is known that I0 will be somewhere here, and the resultant of I0 and I2 dash is I1, and I1 is decided now. So to get V1, we need to add J I1 XL1 drop to the minus E1. So this is minus E1 phasor, so maintaining perpendicular with I1, draw J I1 XL1 drop, and the resultant is V1. Next, consider the capacitor load case, and the common thing here is flux phi, minus E1 and E2 and V2, and as here capacitor load, which means to V2 current I2 will be leading. Let us suppose current I2 is somewhere here. So to get E2, from V2 draw J I2 XL2 drop maintaining perpendicular with I2 phasor. As here perpendicular I2 XL2 drop is not possible, that implies that V2 will not be here, V2 will be here. Therefore now draw perpendicular from V2, which represents J I2 XL2 drop by maintaining perpendicular to I2 phasor. This gives you E2, and as now it is decided, I2 dash is decided like this, and I0 will be somewhere here, and now the resultant of I2 dash and I0 is I1. And to get V1, to minus E1, add J I1 XL1 drop maintaining perpendicular with I1 phasor. So by maintaining perpendicular J I1 XL1 drop, and the resultant is V1. For easy calculations and simpler analysis, sometimes it is needed or necessary to transfer the primary side leakage reactance to secondary side, or secondary side leakage reactance to primary side. Let us suppose the primary side leakage reactance is transferred to secondary side, then the circuit will be like this. This will be the primary side leakage reactance which is transferred, and this is the secondary side leakage reactance XL2, and this is the load. And please keep in mind that by transferring the one side leakage reactance to the other side, it shouldn't disturb the other parameters. So is why the condition for transferring one side leakage reactance to the other side is percentage leakage reactance drop before transfer is equal to the percentage leakage reactance drop after transfer. As here the primary side leakage reactance is transferred to the secondary side, apply this condition, that is percentage leakage reactance drop before transfer. So before transfer, the percentage leakage reactance drop is I1 XL1 by E1. Okay, must be equal to the percentage leakage reactance drop after transfer. And after transfer, the percentage leakage reactance drop is I2 XL1 dash by E2, and which implies E2 by E1 into I1 by I2 is equal to XL1 dash by XL1. And it is known that E2 by E1 is equal to K, and I1 by I2 is equal to K, which implies K square is equal to XL1 dash by XL1. That implies XL1 dash is equal to K square times XL1. This is the important relation for transferring the primary side leakage reactance to secondary side. And similarly, if you want to transfer the secondary side leakage reactance to the primary side and apply this condition, then you will get XL2 dash is equal to the XL2 by k square. And simply to remember, if you are transferring the secondary side resistance or secondary side leakage reactance to the primary side, then the new value of resistance or leakage reactance is the actual value by k square, that is this. And similarly, if you want to transfer primary side resistance or leakage reactance to the secondary side, then the new value of resistance or leakage reactance is the actual value into k square, that is this. Now let's study the effects due to both leakage reactance and resistance. First, let's write the voltage equations. So V1 is equal to minus E1 plus I1 R1 plus J I1 XL1. And here E2 is equal to I2 R2 plus I2 J XL2 plus V2. Now let's consider the rest to load case. And the common thing what we know in phasor diagram is minus E1 and E2, and this is flux phi and no load current I0 and its component I mu and IC, and V2 will be like this. So now as residual load is considered, V2 and I2 will be in phase. So here I2, as now I2 is decided, I2 dash will be like this, and resultant of I0 and I2 dash is I1, as E2 is the vector sum of V2 and I2 J XL2 and I2 R2. So to get E2, we need to add I2 R2 and I2 J XL2 to V2. So from V2, add I2 R2 drop, and this I2 R2 drop must be parallel to I2. Therefore, from V2, draw I2 R2 phasor maintaining parallel with I2, and then add I2 JXL2, and this drop must be perpendicular to I2 phasor. So from I2 maintaining perpendicular, draw J I2 XL2 drop, and now the resultant is E2. And similarly, V1 is the resultant here. So to get V1 to minus E1, we need to add I1 R1 drop and J I1 XL1 drop. As we got I1, so from minus E1, add I1 R1 drop first, and this I1 R1 drop must be parallel to I1 phasor. So this is I1 R1 drop, and then from here, maintaining perpendicular, draw I1 XL1 drop. So this is I1 XL1 drop, and now the resultant is V1. Similarly, now consider inductive load. Therefore, the common phasor diagram what we know is minus E1, E2, phi, and I0, and their components I mu and IC, and V2 will be here. And now as inductor load is considered, so to V2, I2 will be in lagging by angle phi 2. Therefore I2 dash is like this, and now resultant of I0 and I2 dash is I1, and here E2 is the resultant. So to get I2, we need to add I2 R2 drop and I2 JXL2 drop to V2. So from V2, add I2 R2 drop. This drop must be parallel to I2 phasor, like this, I2 R2 drop. And then from here, maintaining perpendicular to I2, add I2 JXL2 drop. So like this, I2 JXL2 drop. And now the resultant is E2. And similarly, V1 is resultant. So to get V1, we need to add I1 R1 drop and J I1 XL1 drop to minus E1. So maintaining parallel with I1, from minus E1, add I1 R1 drop. And then from there, maintaining perpendicular with I1 phasor, draw J I1 XL1 drop, and now the resultant is V1. So the angle between V1 and I1 is phi 1, Next, let's consider capacitor load. And the common phase diagram, what we know is minus E1, E2, phi, phi naught, and their components IC and IMU. And V2 is here. As now capacitor load is considered, so current I2 will be leading with V2 by an angle phi 2, and now as I2 is decided, I2 dash will be somewhere here, and the resultant of I0 and I2 dash is I1. Next, as E2 is resultant, so to get E2 from V2 we need to add I2 R2 and I2 XL2 drops. Therefore, from V2, maintaining parallel with I2, draw I2 R2 drop, and then maintaining perpendicular with I2 phasor, draw J I2 XL2 drop. This is J I2 XL2 drop, and now the resultant is E2. And now let's obtain V1, which is resultant of adding I1 R1 and J I1 XL1 to minus E1. So from minus E1, maintaining parallel, draw I1 R1 drop, and then from here, maintaining perpendicular with I1 phasor, draw I1 XL1 drop, and now the resultant is V1. These are the phasor diagrams of a transformer by considering the leakage reactance effect and resistance effect under different loading conditions. Now let's obtain its equivalent circuit. The electrical equivalent circuit of the transformer is obtained by transferring all the secondary side parameters to the primary side. Now let's see how these are transferred from secondary side to primary side. The schematic diagram for this transformer is, this is the primary winding, and this is the transformer core, and this is the secondary winding, and this is the secondary resistance R2, and this is secondary leakage reactance XL2, and this is the load. Similarly here, shunt branch circuit consisting of resistance R0 and reactance X0 and the primary side leakage reactance XL1 and primary side resistance R1 and supply voltage V1, and here the secondary current is I2. So this is the schematic diagram of actual transformer. And now if you can transfer all the secondary side parameters to the primary side, then we can get the electrical equivalent circuit of a transformer. And after doing that, there is no necessity of drawing this idle circuit diagram. And it is studied that for transferring the secondary side resistance to the primary side, that resistance is referred with R2 dash, and which is equal to R2 by K square. And similarly, if secondary side leakage reactance is transferred to primary side, that is represented with XL2 dash, which is equal to XL2 by K square. And if voltage is transferred to primary side, that is represented with E2 dash, which is equal to E2 by K. And if current is transferred to primary side, I2 dash is equal to K into I2. In equivalent circuit of transformer, from here to here, this is the common circuit. So let's first draw that. So V1, and this is R1, and this is XL1, and this is shunt branch, R0 and X0, R0 consisting of IC and X0 consisting of IMU, and this is I0 current. First, E2 must be transferred to primary side, which is represented with E2 dash, and which is equal to E2 by K, and that is equal to E1. We seen from this circuit that from here to here it is E1, and now as E2 is transferred to primary side, which is equated to E2 dash, and that is equal to E2 by K. Next, let's transfer I2 current, and which is represented with I2 dash, and which is equal to K into I2. And now transfer the second side resistance to the primary side, and which is represented with R2 dash, and that is equated to R2 by K square. Next, let's transfer the second side leakage reactance to primary side, which is represented with XL2 dash, and which is equal to XL2 by K square. XL2 by K square. And now, finally, transfer the load voltage to the primary side, and which is represented with V2 dash, and which is equal to V2 by K. This is the equivalent circuit of actual transformer, and for further simplification, this shunt branch is shifted towards the source side, means like this. And while doing that, few assumptions are made. That is, as we know that I1 is equal to I0 plus I2 dash, means due to resistance R1 and current I0, there are copper losses I0 square R1, and due to I2 dash and R1, there are I2 dash square R1 copper loss. If this is current I1 and this is I0 and this is I2. So observe here that now in this resistance only I2 dash current is present. There is no I0 current, whereas here there is I0 current flowing through R1. Means here the copper losses due to I0 current is neglected. And second assumption is, observe that here this input voltage is applied across R1 XL1 and this shunt branch, whereas here the entire input voltage is applied across the shunt branch. And as core losses depends on the input voltage, as here input voltage applied across the shunt branch is increased, means here core losses are increased. These are the main two assumptions which are made while shifting the shunt branch towards the source side. And this is the approximate equivalent circuit of transformer. And you can further simplify this, that is, as now R1 and R2 dash are in series, and you can represent these two together as R01, which is equal to R1 plus R2 dash. And similarly, as XL1 and XL2 dash are in series, so these two can be added and represented as X01, which is equal to XL1 plus XL2 dash. And these two together you can represent as simply impedance Z01, which is equal to R01 plus JX01. And you can also transfer primary side parameters to the secondary side. If you do so, then the entire resistance is represented with R02 and the entire reactance is represented with X02, and combinedly that impedance is represented with Z02.